We got some more stuff to do. Oh, hey. You appear right behind me. How are you? Ah, Mistress Waters. It is well that you are here. You are wanted within. I believe Master Alphino wishes a word with you. Ah, Delara. There you are. Have you a moment? There is something I would fain discuss. I must ask you to recall the events which unfolded at the peace conference, though I dare say you would sooner forget them. My mind returns again and again to the moment when Nidhogg appeared before the crowd in the guise of Astinian. It was a sight to chill the soul, but one which gave me reason to hope that our friend might not be beyond salvation. When you described his fateful transformation at Izzy's Law, I feared him lost forever, but the mere fact that some semblance of his former self endures must surely count for something. Alas, I have no evidence to support this impression. Thus did I turn the Ishtola and Kryl for a more empirical appraisal, and full glad am I that I did, for it would seem they have some observations of their own to share. The ladies have saved us a table at the Forgotten Knight. Shall we go? Excellent. Let us not keep our honored colleagues waiting.
We have kept you waiting over long, I fear.
Not to worry, Alphino. We had some rather fine mulled wine to keep us company. Truth be told, you could have delayed your arrival a few moments more.
Gibreon got the spicing just right this time. His latest batch is not only delicious and warming, but soothing to the humours.
Indeed. But 'twas not to soothe our humours that we gathered here.
Oh, no, quite right. The matter of that poor dragoon.
You have discovered something. A means to save him?
Let us not jump to conclusions, shall we? Assess the facts presented, then make an educated analysis, as you were taught.
Pray, cast your mind back to the moment of Astinian's transformation. Do you recall how you described it to us? You spoke of the sudden pangs which racked his body when you took up both of Nidhogg's eyes, and of how his form was twisted thereafter into a shadowy semblance of the Great Worm.
When he appeared at Falcon's Nest, the Worm's eyes were fused to his mail.
Would that only his armor had been corrupted. Snaking forth from the eyes, I descried dark tendrils which entangled his very being. His ether has been all but smothered.
Then he is lost to us forever?
What did I just say about jumping to conclusions? Ishtola clearly stated all but smothered. As I later discovered, her impression matched my own. Though Nidhogg's presence filled my mind's eye, beneath his seething aura, I sensed the merest hint of something else. And after listening to Yishtola's observations, I became more certain of my suspicion that the something else I had sensed was, in fact, the trace of a different will, submerged in the sea of Nidhogg's rage.
You mean?
Yes, 'tis like that Astinian spirit yet lingers.
Can we not wrest him from Nidhogg's grasp, then? Tear the eyes from the armor?
We know not if that would serve to separate Worm's soul from man's. None have ever attempted such a feat.
Should it offer even the faintest hope of success, then by the gods, I shall be the first to try.
Alphino. By all means, hold fast to your hope, but be mindful of the dangers. Even should you succeed in excising the eyes from the dragoon's mail, we have no way of knowing if your friend's soul would survive so violent a separation. And that is to say nothing of the possibility that his would-be savior might become Nidhogg's next host.
But what other choice remains to us? Should the opportunity present itself, I will tear those foul orbs from Estinian's armor and trust in the resilience of his soul, even at the risk of mine own.
Ah, I found you at last. A messenger of the Temple Knights came to the manor some few hours past. The Lord Commander humbly requests the company of the Warrior of Light and Master Alphino.
Sir Emmerich would speak with us. Very well, thank you, Anuwa.
T'would seem duty calls. Pray see to yours, and we shall return to ours.
Thank you, Yshtola, Kryl. Your words have given me hope where there was none. Come then, Sir Emmerich awaits.
Alphino is allowing his feelings for this dragoon to cloud his thoughts. I worry he may do something rash. Keep an eye on him, would you?
They think more of their friends' deliverance than their foes' defeat. But will history commend their fealty or condemn their folly?
The conference held at Falcon's Nest was to be a celebration of the reconciliation twixt man and dragon. But the lingering shade of Nidhogg, clad in the flesh of the Azure Dragoon, did mark the occasion by spilling the blood of his own kind. A timely atrocity to remind the children of Ishgard that the Dragonsong War was far from over. And when fear gave way to fury, the call to arms rang out anew. Death to Nidhogg. Death to Nidhogg.
What news has Sir Emmerich to share with us, I wonder? Might Sir Emmerich perchance have received word of a Dravanian advance? Or mayhap they have located mayhap Nidhogg has been found. Come, I would hear what the Lord Commander has to say.
My friends, I thank you for coming.
You have had news of Nidhogg?
Alas, not. Our scouts range far and wide, but they have as yet found no trace of the Great Worm.
We dispatched an elite unit of dragoons to reconnoiter the churning mists, but even they returned empty-handed.
A pity.
Fear not, Alphino. We shall see the Worm again soon enough. His words at Falcon's Nest attest to that. Indeed, he is like to come sooner than we would wish.
I assume Ishgard's defenses are being bolstered as we speak?
With all haste, I mean to call upon every able-bodied warrior at our disposal, from the Knights of the Four Houses to the men and women of the Watch. But I did not summon you to discuss strategy.
What then would you have of us, my lord?
I will speak plain. Now that Nidhogg is possessed of both of his eyes, No mortal force we can muster will repel him. That being the case, we must needs recruit an ally of equal strength.
You speak of Hreisvelga?
I do. To whom else could we turn?
That he is Nidhogg's equal, I do not deny. Nor can I name another. But convincing the reclusive creature to do battle with his own brood brother will be... How shall I put this?
It will be no small undertaking, yes. Estinian's report was most particular about Hreisvelga's unwillingness to involve himself in the affairs of men. But much has changed since your visit to Somal, and if there is even a chance that the dragon may be swayed, I must plead our case. Whatever price the dragon asks of me, I shall pay it. Such was my oath, to defend the people of Ishgard. Come what may, my friends, the battle with Nidhogg will mark the end of my tenure as the acting head of church and state. Will you help me discharge this final duty?
We will, my lord, though I fear our involvement offers no guarantee of success. Come then, we will depart at your leisure.
Thank you. Both of you. The city is yours, First Commander.
My lord, we shall pray for your swift return.
It grieves me to impose upon you in this manner, but you of all people understand the threat we now face. It is no imposition, Sir Emmerich. To Delara and I, Ishgard is as a second home. After the many battles we have fought and the bonds we have forged, the plight of your nation has become our own. If there is aught that we can do to aid in its salvation, then pray impose all you must. You are true friends. Shall we be about our task then? We have no way of knowing when Nidhogg's shade will strike, but we must assume that time is not our ally. Indeed. With that in mind, I have taken the liberty of dispatching a messenger to inform Mistress Tataru that you will be escorting me to Salm Ul. I confess I did not provide the exact details of our destination, as they are as yet unknown to me. We will summon Hreisvelga at Zenith in the Churning Mist. Ere we begin our ascent, however, I think it best that we pay a visit to Annex Trine. You seek an advantage in the coming negotiations? I do. I will consult with Vedafnir. I propose this in part out of concern for her condition. Were she to succumb to her wounds, it could have grave consequences for our alliance. That apart, she may be able to provide insight into her sire's current state of mind. Well reasoned. For the Drevanian Forelands, then. Ah, 'tis the warrior of warriors and her companions. What bringeth you to mine abode? Pray forgive us for disturbing your recuperation, Vedafnir. I hope your wound does not pain you overmuch. Didst thou imagine me close to death? The thrust was deep, but not mortal. I will heal in time. Full glad am I to hear it. You are the guest of honor at our conference, and we failed in our duty of protection. On behalf of Ishgard, I apologize unreservedly. I am a dragon full grown, and thou thought to protect me, mortal? I was tempered by the fires of battle ere thy great-grandsire learned to crawl. Thy words do remind me of a knight whom I called friend some thousand years past. He swore to defend me from harm and hardship. Would that we could return to that era of peace, when man and dragon knew such comradeship. Oh man. Would that our every effort to do so were not undone by ancient rancor. For a truth, there can be no peace while Nidhogg's shade yet lingereth. That much is plain, yet we lack the strength to banish him. Thus do we make for some all to beseech the aid of your sire once more. Folly, thou knowest as well as I how he will answer. Bracefugger's heart remains unchanged then. A pity. But if it is folly to hope, I am content to die a fool. As hath ever been the way with thy kind. Go then, but be warned. The Shade's presence hath driven its minions to frenzy. Thank you, Vidafnir. We shall disturb your rest no longer. Though I expected no better answer from Vidafnir, I take little pleasure from having been proven right. It seems that our presence at Zenith will be every bit as unwelcome as I had anticipated. But what is the ire of one great worm to a trio of self-confessed fools such as ourselves? Let us begin our ascent. After you, Mr. Alfano. Scout ahead if you wish, Delara. We shall join you outside Mogholm. I had heard tales of the world above the clouds, but never did I dream. One's mind paints a pale picture of its majesty. Few live to see such wonders. I am reminded of my first visit to this peak, when Astinian and Azalea yet walked at our side.
Kapopo? Is that you, Delara?
Ah, if it isn't Mog... Don't tell me you forgot my name, Kupo! After all, we've been through together! But at least you remember me. You do remember me, don't you, Delara? of course I do, Moghand. You seemed a bit hesitant for a moment there, but I'm sure you were just fondly recalling the time we camped near Zenith, right, Kupo? But putting our shared history to one side, what brings you and your friends to Mogholm, Kupo? Ah, another audience with old Hraesvegr. Well, I hope you brought the horn, Kupo. With the wings as gentle as they are, a good loud toot should reach the great worm's ears easily enough. That is good to hear, Moghan. Thank you. We had best press on to Zenith, while the winds are in our favor. Now that was unexpected, Kupo. Chieftain Moglin will want to hear about this. I'm about to toot into the wind.
own anger.
Great Hraesvelga, 'tis not lightly that we beg this audience. Pray hearken to our words, for they concern the future of man and dragon both.
Greetings, Hraesvelga. I am Emeric de Burrell, acting ruler of the nation of Ishgard. I am come before you to parley on behalf of my people. Saw mine intent.
Alle in esnes nale an nal ulle in. Alle in esk dich wie I en udran fakin an shi. Lis ech nit heg casmon ikini, lis nuan jas an es in, salen mon an es undai in. Stahol I an I nit heg, shin hes iso, al nuo fa is.
We understand that in your despair at man's betrayal, you seek only the refuge of solitude. But despite your protestations of spent faith, do you not still nurture the smallest flame of hope? I do. If you claim I see falsely, then tell me, why did you consent to bear Rizel upon your back?
Easy. I see you. Holes, esk dear falsu, nesk an in esk.
So you do distinguish between those who acknowledge and repent their sins and those who perpetuate them. Interesting. It seems to me that you have not, in fact, lost faith in mankind as a whole. Rather, you weigh our respective merits by how we allow the past to influence our future.
Should we suffer ties of blood to bind our hands, then? Nay, if the crime is one of unconscionable evil, we must needs condemn it, even should the transgressor be our closest kin. When my father corrupted himself and his followers with the power of a primal, I beseeched the Warrior of Light to slay him, an act alike to patricide. That he did not die by my hand matters little. If anything, it heaps greater disgrace upon my name. But had my father not fallen, he would have drawn countless thousands into a holy war of hellish proportions, which I hold the greater crime. Thus did I order his execution, sparing the lives of my people and yours. Alas, your brother Worm now prepares to murder those whom I sought to spare. What is more, he has taken my comrade's body for his own. But if I must slay my dearest friend to defeat my direst foe, I will not flinch from my duty.
Sekhmon Infim, Sesghantis Ekmon, Kin Ud. Eskenitek Eskedia Ulgar An El In An Hesnesh An Esk Jas Ong N An On Inga. Al In An Uwoga Sma Es In An Sway In Tuska dis die an Sosk kin Skor ich les ilo
I believe I spied a wyvern landing just outside the palace. It is doubtless one of the children of whom Hreisvelgr spoke. Come, my friends, let us not keep our escort waiting. My broodmates and I will bear you to the place of your trial. Make your preparations.
Noble Om Ankin Inesnesh. Ankin Alewa Rail Ina Saihudles. S. Seasten A. Sleece like Kema.
Your trial is ended as well, then?
Mine was brutal beyond reckoning. Vedfolnir seems ill-acquainted with the notion of mock battles.
Oh, my poor ribs! Brazevagar saw fit to pair me with a Vanafnir, but her ferocity was such that I began to wonder if I hadn't simply imagined her injury. Yet my trial pales into insignificance next to yours. How fared you in your duel with Brazevagar? I take from this that your battle was rather more involved than my own. Brafnir seemed largely concerned with how long he could keep me rolling in the dust. Between dodging, snapping fangs, and slashing claws, I scarce had time to aim a blow. Had he truly meant to harm me, of course, I would not be standing here now. Plainly, his intent was to teach. His onslaught forced me to recall my training about the speed of the dragon, his balance, his blind spots. It was, in short, a very thorough lesson.
Oh, Kubo, Delara, let me begin by congratulating you on the completion of your trial. One with a name more befitting a jester, you fight with the savagery of a rabid demon. Did you see how my wings are kinked? Even my palm aches. After this drubbing, I fear my loyal subjects will have to bear the load of my personal chores for quite some time, Kupo. Possibly indefinitely. What? When I told you about Delara's trial, I didn't mean for the rest of us to suffer.
That's triple shifts for you, Moghan.
Triple? That's not fair! There's no justice, Kupo! None at all!
Our negotiations proved rather more strenuous than I had anticipated, but the results seem well worth the effort.
The battle was indeed hard won. Thank you, my friends. I would never have earned Hraesvelga's cooperation had you not seen fit to grant me yours. T'was your stalwart heroism that moved the heart of the Great Worm at the last. Any gratitude I can offer is but poor reward for your continued service to Ishgard.
would seem our final reckoning with the Dread Worm is at hand. I only wish we had some inkling as to when he means to strike.
It has begun. We must away to Ishgard.
Ishgard will not last long against Nidhogg and his horde. We must away.
I must return to my city without delay.
Until the Lord Commander returns. We must hold.
Fury. That one is the size of Nidhogg.
You are late, Warrior of Light.
Thank you.
Snalisre in Nendwar Elstra.
Thank you.
Astinian!
Is this to be mine end? Nay, I will not allow it. I am of the first brood. I am vengeance incarnate. I am Nidhogg! Thou shalt die by my hand!
This is not your hand, worm!
Thou wilt obey!
I would ask one last favor of you, Warrior of Light. Finish me! Now, while I have the beast subdued! Ah! Ah! You waste your time! Kill me! It is the only way! Ending Nidhogg will be my final duty!
No! You can't die like this! I won't let you!
Thank you.
He lives. Ah, Astinian, my ill-fated friend. Lucia, summon the healers. I want them ready to receive him.
At once, Lord Commander.
Allow me to do this much, at least. My gratitude, Res Velga. Your deeds this day have saved a great many lives.
The battle is won. We can do no more for Astinian now than bear him home and wish him well, even as Hraesvelgr did. The rest we must trust to the hands of the healers and the grace of the gods.
Through the haze of pain, I swear I sensed. But no. The past is done, and we must look to the future. At long last, Nidhogg is gone. His foul spirit cast out once and for all. I only pray that Astinian survives the ordeal. Your battle with Nidhogg's shade will beget many an epic ballad, Delara. And rightly so. It was, without a doubt, one of your more apocal victories. Though I must admit that I took greater joy in seeing you emerge from the experience unscathed. And not only for your own sake, had you not been there to aid me, those infernal eyes would still be fused to Astinian's mail. Yet even with Nidhogg gone, I cannot help but wonder how much of our friend remains. Let us pay a visit to Lucia and beg news of his condition. Delara, Master Afanel. My honored friends, as if winning Hraesvelgr to our cause were not enough, you took it upon yourselves to rid us of his brood brother. I know not how to thank you. My own contribution was hardly noteworthy. The true saviors of the day were Delara and Astinian. One triumphed over Nidhogg's shade through strength of arms, and the other through strength of will. And speaking of Astinian, what news of his recovery? The Azure Dragoon was conveyed to the infirmary, where he now resides under the care of our Hospitaller Captain. I am told he has yet to regain consciousness. But as you know, Astinian's mind and body were held hostage for many days. We must be patient and allow the process of healing to begin. In the meantime, you would do well to rest and recover from your own ordeals. But surely, Sir Emmerich is never long from Astinian's bedside, and will send word the moment there are any developments. Now, if I have satisfied your concerns, I believe Lord Edmond and his sons are most eager to celebrate your return. Very well, First Commander. Come, Delara. It would seem that we are awaited at Fortal Manor.
The heroes of the hour return.
We but did our duty, my lord. It was the memories of fallen friends and not our heroism which saw us through at the last.
I gave every ounce of my strength, but mine efforts would have counted for naught had the Warrior of Light not arrived to challenge the Great Worm. As a sworn knight of Ishgard, I had hoped to do more for my city.
Well, we cannot all be heroes, dear brother. Let us put away our pride for a moment and revel in the valiant deeds of our comrade. For your sterling service to Ishgard, we salute you. And while we're on the subject of valiant deeds, I believe I myself have earned some small measure of recognition. Under my watchful command, the ballistas of the Outer Ward struck down a veritable swarm of Dravanian invaders.
My lord's command was certainly watchful. He bravely watched as the siege crews took aim, and continued to watch as countless wyverns met their end. Indeed, the ward's defenders proved so well-drilled that my lord had little occasion to stop watching.
There will be time enough to determine who is most deserving of recognition later. Our friends are doubtless weary from their exertions. I had chambers prepared in expectation of your return. You are welcome to retire at your leisure.
I am most grateful for your hospitality, my lord, but I believe I shall pay a visit to the Temple Knight's infirmary. Pray excuse me.
Our master Alfinor has grown. The plight of his stricken brother in arms pains him more than his own hurts. In which respect he has come to resemble you, Warrior of Light. Go then, visit the Azure Dragoon, and grant him what comfort you may.
Delara, my friend. What can I do for the savior of Ishgard? You seek Master Alfino. Ah, he came to relieve me of my vigil a short while ago. When he begged to set Asinian aside, I could not well refuse him. Though he would sooner faint than admit it, the boy must be exhausted by Hraesvegr's trial and all that followed. Asinian is blessed to have such devoted comrades. My own friendship with Asinian began some 10 years past, shortly after we joined the Temple Knights. I learned his name soon enough, but Asinian barely registered my existence. I was less a fellow recruit and more a shadow which occasionally darkened his path. And so I might have remained, had fate not seen fit to intervene. While out on patrol, our company was set upon by a dragon, and we were the only two to survive. The experience forged a bond between us, as such life-threatening situations are wont to do. Despite our friendship, he remained an intense, solitary youth, wholly obsessed with claiming vengeance against Nidhogg. Revenge was ever at the forefront of his mind, revenge for the death of his parents, and revenge for his younger brother. I would venture that in Alfino he sees something of his lost sibling. And in the ungentle chidings of Asinian, Alfino has found the elder brother he never had. Truth be told, Asinian's tactless observations have saved me from disaster more than once, and I can well understand Alfino's affection for him. He is a friend for whom I would gladly... Lord Commander, your presence is required in the infirmary. Is he? Tell them I'm on my way. Quickly, Laura, we must go to him.
Cassilian!
Cease your mewling, boy. It grates my ears.
Forgive me. When I saw you awaken, I could not... It was such a relief. We feared you might never wake up.
Now, Astinian. If Master Alphino thought any less of you, you would still be Nidhogg's plaything. Or dead.
Aye, 'twas but a jest. I thank you, Alphino. And you too, Warrior of Light. Quite how you managed to persuade Hraesvogr to aid in his brood brother's downfall, I cannot imagine. But full glad am I that you did. Yet again, you have achieved the impossible.
I, for my part, owe you an apology. When last we met, I did willingly loose an arrow at your heart. Can you forgive me?
There is naught to forgive, Hemeric. You but acted in defense of Ishgard, as is your duty. Were you any less single-minded about it, I would not follow you into battle, nor trust you at my back. Besides, I had come to the selfsame conclusion that I would have to perish for Nidhogg to be stopped. So let us dispense with the hand-wringing. I have heard enough mewling for one day.
Oh!
The tendrils of Nidhogg's foul presence bound up every fiber of my being, usurping my senses, but I yet retained some trace of awareness. The worm's mind was as a vast and tumultuous sea. Endlessly its black waters churned, his grief and despair at Ratatoska's murder never calming, never receding. Driven by this surging current came wave upon wave of unrelenting rancor. It was the very image of my own heart. There I saw the dark reflection of the hatred I felt after Nidhogg slew my family. When no path remained save vengeance against dragonkind. Neither one of us had a choice. But I was blessed with something Nidhogg was not. Comrades and teachers to console and admonish me. Had I not had them to gainsay my obsession, it would surely have consumed me as Nidhogg's did him, and we would have been in all respects alike. Though his shade is banished, his spirit scattered upon the sea of clouds, I feel no joy at his passing. Where once I craved vengeance, I now crave rest.
Lord Commander, my hunt is at an end. I would lay down the mantle of Azure Dragoon. My friend.
He has tired himself with too many words. I doubt not that he will make a full recovery, but he must be allowed some few days of quiet.
Must see my path to its end. Sleep well, my friend.
Following the battle with Nidhogg on the steps of Faith, Sir Emery called an assembly that he might make his final proclamation as acting head of state. T'was there, with one decree, that the 1,000-year rule of the archbishops was ended, paving the way for a new republic. The governance of Ishgard would now be placed in the hands of high and lowborn alike, their ranks represented by the newly founded House of Lords and House of Commons. Church was separated from state. The foundation for change had been carefully laid, and the reforms proposed by Ishgard's new government passed into law without incident. His duty done, Emeric de Borel gladly stepped down from the Archbishop's dais, only to be raised unto the highest seat in the House of Lords. Though he strove at first to refuse this honor, the unexpectedly strident voice of the Count de Durandere left him little choice but to accept. And so it was that the winds of gentle revolution came to stir. Prominent among the many honored guests at Sir Emeric's investiture were the ambassadors of Dragonkind, a fitting symbol of Ishgard's newfound peace. People looked on in awe as he soared through the heavens on dragon back, and by their cheers did they hail him an Azure Dragoon for a new age. Thus were the notes of the dragon song rewritten, the din of war giving way to a rising litany of peace and hope.
I was gazing out at the sea of clouds in an all-too-rare moment of idleness, when I chanced to behold a certain hero wending her way towards the sea on Dragonback. Welcome home, Delara. Nay, 'twas no great matter that moved me to greet you in person. Between you and me, I merely sought respite from the pressures of office. No sooner do I surrender my role as temporary head of state than I am burdened with a position of more permanent responsibility. I fancy that it echoes in some small measure the way you must feel when your improbable feats of heroism are rewarded with still more impossible challenges. The myth which guided our society for generations lies in tatters. Am I then to be scorned for building upon the system of nobility that I once sought to tear down? And what a strange jest is this that places me at its pinnacle? An archbishop's bastard at the head of the House of Lords. These questions are for me to answer. It is not in man's nature to change overnight. This I learned through painful experience, and it was this hard lesson which convinced me to take the path which we now follow. Even as we rebuild the bridge between man and dragon, so must we reimagine Ishgard, one carefully placed stone at a time. We must remember that it is not for us that we lay this groundwork, but for the men and women that our children will become. May their towers rise proudly from the fundament of our legacy. I hear word from Captain Whitecape that Ascinian has vanished from his sick room. His wolfiness survives undiminished. Should you ever happen upon our unmannerly friend on your travels, pray assure him that I shall keep Ishgard safe until he deigns to come home. Thank you, Delara, and please, convey my warmest regards to Master Alphanel. You spoke with Sir Emmerich? I do not envy him his new position. Ishgard has chosen a new road, but one littered with the vitreous of a thousand years of broken faith. Yet though her people may stumble from time to time, I know of none better than Sir Emmerich to lead the march of progress. As for us, there remains the small matter of ushering in a new dawn in the shadow of inscrutable Ascian machinations in a seemingly less endless procession of primals. But we too must walk our chosen path, no matter how treacherous the footing. Thank you, Blanhart. Nay, you need not remain there. We shall rendezvous at the usual place. All is proceeding as expected, then. There is naught to concern us, aside from one overly curious mouse. This way. Him again. It is of no moment. They will play their part, and we will play ours.